So let us begin today's session, which is application of CFD for electronic thermal management. The roadmap that will follow for today's 20 minutes webinar session is, first we'll have a welcome and introduction. After that we'll have the entire webinar presentation. Then in the end we'll take questions if you have any, and we'll have closing of this webinar. So before we begin, thank you for your registration and for attending this particular session. This is an introductory webinar on electronic thermal management simulations. It is a sixth webinar in a series of webinars which will be conducted by LearnCX in future as well. This webinar is designed to act as an introduction to electronic thermal simulations process using CFD. So it will give you the introductory knowledge of how CFD is applied in electronic thermal management, but won't go into detail of that. So before we begin, some information about LearnCX as an organization. LearnCX is an initiative of training division at CCTEC, which is Center for Computational Technologies, Pune, which is located in Pune, India. It has industry focused courses for CAD and CFD, and our model, which is totally based on online training, that is through internet, it helps participants learn complex CAE technologies with ease at a time and place of their choice. So let us begin our webinar presentation now. First, we'll see what do we mean by CFD for the participants who are fresh to the idea of CFD. Computational fluid dynamics provides a qualitative as well as quantitative prediction of fluid flow by means of mathematical modeling, that is partial differential equations, numerical methods using discretization and solution techniques, and it uses software tools on computers in order to do that. So computational fluid dynamics, as a definition, it is actually science of predicting fluid flow, heat transfer, mass transfer, chemical reactions and related phenomena by solving mathematical equations using a computer. So as these phenomena like heat transfer, mass transfer are closely related to fluid flow, it also comes under the gamut of computational fluid dynamics. We'll have a brief overview of the CFD process flow. First, we build the geometry using various CAD tools or inbuilt geometry tool. Then we mesh the particular geometry by using meshing or grid generation tools. After that, we define physical boundary conditions or inputs. Then we compute the solution by using solver softwares. And in the end, we extract results out of the solver software. So in short, this is the process under which pre-processing, that is the first step, we do geometry creation and geometry cleanup, mesh or grid generation and boundary conditions. Under the solver, we basically define the problem statement and we let the solver computer solve the numerics of it. And in post-processing, we understand the flow and the entire phenomenon by using various post-processing or image results like contours, colors, graphs, etc. So CFD is actually linked to the process where we study various physics using mathematical equations and then use numerical techniques, and under that we have various algorithms like finite difference, finite element and finite volume. Other methods of studying physics may be like experimental analysis or analytical solution, but CFD or simulations comes into the category of mathematical equations and numerical solutions. So now once we have understood what CFD is and what is the mathematical idea behind using simulations, we'll see application of CFD within the electronics field. As you might know, electronics field has various applications in many other fields like aerospace, controls, transmission, etc. So these are few of the applications within different fields, some of the results within the electronic domain. And electronic within electronic domain, we encounter simulations in component level flow and cooling applications, in telecommunication equipments, engine and transmission controls, as well as magnetic storage devices. Also, coupling of electromagnetic simulation and CFD is a standard practice. Now, where does the need for controlling temperature or modeling or simulating temperature within an electronic thermal system comes into picture? Moore's law is the very basis of basic law within the electronic field, which states that after every year the transistors on a particular application or chip goes on doubling, which means that the capacity of a particular electronic chip is just increasing exponentially, and it leads to a lot more performance, but it also simultaneously leads to a lot more heat dissipation or the thermal thermal management problem. So the power in watts of a chip per unit area has grown exponentially since the development of electronic chips or packages. Development in semiconductor technology is the main cause of it. But the heat removal technology of out of this chip, which because of Joule heating and other heating phenomenon, it's still catching up. The technology to remove that heat is still catching up. It's not that rapid development, and components operate in wide range of temperature. So we have from in aerospace applications a very large temperature, where in rest of the normal applications like computers etc. we have temperatures in the range of 80 degrees centigrade and so on. So hence cooling or thermal management is still a big issue in electronics, and thermal related failures are still a major cause of concern. Every component has specific operating temperature, and they have to be maintained within that temperature in order to ensure that they do not get damaged. So increasing power density results in increasing heat dissipation, and that heat dissipation leads to temperature or thermal problems within electronic components. Also, higher temperature may lead to other breakdowns due to reasons like chemical reactions, dielectric breakdown, electromigration, material creep, and thermal cycling or fatigue in solder joints and board warpage, etc. So because of this, there may be other issues because of high temperature, like accelerated thermal reactions and the rest of the things. In order to study the temperature phenomenon or temperature issue within electronic system, we have to consider phenomenons or physics like conduction, convection, radiation, fluid flow, pressure drop has also is also to be modeled. Extended surfaces and conduction between them is also to be considered. External techniques can be used along with simulations to come up with better designs. Empirical data is also available, as well as a combination of numerical or computational methods along with standard practices can be used. So these are the entire study areas that we have to care for, or we have to be focused in order to model temperature within electronic system. Now, when we consider that we are going to apply CFD for an electronic thermal management problem, there are three levels at which we can apply CFD. First is system level, in which we deal with the entire cabinet level or outer system level problem. We are interested in maximum exhaust air temperature in those cases. We are also interested in maximum outer surface temperature, also coolant temperature in case of liquid cooled systems. Fan selection or fan performance is also a design criteria. Airflow distribution is of primary importance. Whereas if we go deep into the board level problems, we apply CFD, we are then interested into maximum solder temperatures at board levels, maximum adhesive temperatures, dielectric material performance, PCB temperature distribution, as well as traces that are imported on PCB, and considering Joule heating of that. So that is on the board level. If we consider on device level CFD, we are interested in on the component level. So we are now interested in maximum junction temperature, ambient temperature levels. Thermal characterization also can be done using CFD, as well as package level analysis. Now, a general purpose CFD code can also model electronic thermal management problems, but there are some customized codes which are very popular, which are specifically customized for the for electronic thermal management type of simulations. One of them is ANSYS ISPAC, which uses lots of electronic components in order to compile your electronic model or electronic system level or cabinet or device level model. And it is very user friendly from the point of view of the inputs that are to be given from the electronics specification point of view. Another software which does the same task, which is also popular, is Flowtherm of Mentor Graphics, and it also uses lots of electronic component level models in order to customize the CFD simulation from electronic point of view or electronic perspective. So these are standard packages made for thermal modeling in electronics domain. Now what we'll see is actually a demo case of cabinet level simulation, which has been done using a standard purpose code Fluent. In this demo case, the objective was to investigate the heat removed from PCBs by forced convection, and to compare the component wall temperature with and without forced convection. The real life scenarios or application of such type of analysis is in electronics, where we actually investigate and ensure that the maximum temperature reached by devices under working conditions are within safe limits. Also in computers or computing, to investigate and ensure proper heat removal from computer cabinets, which the heat that is generated from processors and memory chips due to heavy computing. So this is the application of it, and you have to design a cabinet such that heat issues or maximum temperature issues do not occur. So the first case that we have done is the worst case scenario, which is when the fan is off. We have considered a control panel installed with 9 PCBs, each PCB having 9 components. Each PCB generates 24 watt of heat. The unit has been the unit actually has two fans to handle air circulation, but in this particular simulation the fans are basically off to consider the worst case scenario. The inlet for this particular domain is kept at bottom and outlet is kept at top and on the opposite side to avoid recirculation of heated air. Both fans are switched off in this particular simulation, and there is a natural air breeze which is considered to be about 0.5 meter per second entering the cabinet from outlet. So now this is the simulation domain of cabinet level. Here's the outlet, here's the inlet, and these are the 9 PCBs having 9 components mounted on them, and this is a sort of two fans that are considered in this particular application. This is a ramp which is used in order to redirect the air through these PCBs. So we'll see the effect of ramp also in the simulation results. So what happens if we switch off the fans? Basically, we are seeing that all heat dissipating components heat up and reach a very high temperature, which may damage them. There is very low circulation of air. As you can see, for a single PCB, all heat dissipating components have heated up, and the entire board is sort of heated up to a very high temperature, which may damage the board as well as the components. There is very little circulation of air, as seen here in the vector plots. Now let us see a case where we switch on both the fans and they are operating at their performed flow rates. So what happens in that case is the similar type of application or similar type of wattage is considered of 24, but only difference is we are switching on the fans now. So the immediate result in drop down of the temperature that is seen in each of the components as well as PCB. Still there are some components which are having high temperature, which may be due to the size of those components, the watt density might be high, but we are seeing that overall there is drop in temperature, there is very good recirculation of air that is seen, and also this ramp is helping to redirect the air from the inlet into the PCB racks. So that sort of analysis can be done using CFD, and we can see the effect of our design considerations within the results. The PCB have cooled down a lot. We can see the temperature along the PCB is well within acceptable range. As you can see, still there is some imbalance of flow and imbalance of temperature. Some one side of the PCB is getting heated up more than compared to the other, but still the temperature is well within operational range. These are the cut sections which are showing temperature of each components. These are the vectors which is showing that there is a high amount of recirculation compared to the first case, in which the vectors were very low or very less. So the summary of this particular case, which is cabinet level simulation, is that we have applied CFD in order to study cabinet level design, and similarly such analysis can be done for device as well as board level models. Now, if any of the participants here are new to CFD and want to gain much more understanding of CFD or want to get into training of CFD, get trained in the simulation process, what do they need out of as a skill set? So they should have fundamentals of fluid dynamics and thermal sciences, which should be strong. Fundamentals of CFD or understanding of CFD is needed. Knowledge of hands-on knowledge of software usage is needed. How to create grid generation, etc. Expertise in that. Also, how to use CFD for design is also a skill set that is needed. And how to make sense of all the CFD results. And how to make design decisions based on CFD results. So this sort of skill set is needed if somebody wants to get involved into CFD analysis. So related to that, we would like to give you some information of our organization and what it is doing in the area of CFD training or CAD training. So the general practice is to get into a classroom training, which is very rigid in terms of the schedule as well as in terms of the content. So we say that why should you confine yourself to rigid classroom training when we are offering a sort of training which is of the highest quality through internet. You need not travel. All the resources are available at your desk in cost-effective way. You can go over the material any number of times. Also have interactive sessions with our tutors using Skype or WebEx. And we have a huge library of lectures and tutorials which have been prepared by expert faculty, which you can buy through our website. So instead of getting stuck in old times having a rigid classroom training, you can get the best quality training at your doorstep and just by using internet. So what sort of courses do we offer? We offer a basic course which is of CFD modding using Ansys ICM CFD and Ansys Fluent. This is a 6 week course. After this course, one can enter industry knowing simulation knowledge as a CFD analyst. Then we also have advanced course on multiphase flow modeling using Ansys Fluent, which is a 4 week course, as well as advanced course on heat transfer modeling using Ansys Fluent, which is again a 3 week course. We also have a programming course related to computer aided geometric design. It is an intermediate course with focus on fundamental core and advanced topics of computer aided geometric design. It involves lots of coding as well. So if any of you are interested in our training or any of you need information about any of our activities, you can contact us by just visiting our website, that is learncx.com. You can also visit our blogs, which is constantly updated, which is at blog.learncx.com. Like us on our Facebook page. There is lots of free material that is available through Facebook and Twitter. You can also connect or view our videos on YouTube. But the best way to reach us for any of your doubt, whether they are some questions which can be answered free, or if you want to buy any of our courses, you can reach us at info@learncx.com. So that is the end of today's session, which was an introduction to CFD applied for electronic thermal management. If you have any questions of any of the content right now, you can ask. I hope it gave you a short introduction of how CFD is applied on electronic thermal management, what all data you can extract from electronics related simulations, and how a CFD can be used in order to control the temperature within the electronic domain or electronic field. So if you have any questions on these, you can ask. You can also email your questions at info@learncx.com later on. So we are ending this particular session. Thank you for attending again for this particular session, and we look forward to seeing you in many of our future webinars as well, which will be free.